Welcome to It's Your Date with Destiny with Apostle Vivian and Pastor Jemma Duncan of Divine Destiny Worship Center in Diego Martin. For the next 30 minutes, join us as we take you on a journey of maximizing your potential and realizing your goals through Jesus Christ.
Why is it when you need a miracle, it doesn't happen, but when you least expect it, it happens?
You are married. You have challenges in your relationship, but your spouse is unwilling to accede to any counseling. Is divorce an option?
How does a parent handle a promiscuous child?
What are considered the do's and don'ts of a born-again couple who is not yet married?
There are always more questions than answers. So here is Apostle Jemma.
A very good morning to you. Welcome to us, Pastor Jemma. My name is Jemma Duncan, and I'm married to Apostle Vivian Duncan. Together we pastor Divine Destiny Worship Center. Our headquarters is on the main road in Diego Martin, opposite Sudanese Drive. We have branches in Chaguanas, Faisabad, Sangre Grande, Tobago, Rio Claro, and we have a branch in Antigua, in the event that you have a friend or a family member there. We've been talking about God speaking to us, and the question is, I oftentimes hear people say God spoke to me, and I'm usually puzzled, does God really speak to people today? We've gone through quite a bit because this is part three of the little series, and establishing in the Bible the pattern that God had of speaking to people from the very inception. And there is a law in theology, I'm not a theologian, I want to say from the onset, that the law first mentioned that if you want to find out about God and the things he does and how relevant they are today, how lasting they should be, check in the book of Genesis, which is the first book of the Bible, and it tells you how God really wanted things to be. And in Genesis, of course, we know about Adam and Eve, and God would come to talk to them on a daily basis. So if we hold fast or believe or embrace the law first mentioned, one would get the idea that God wanted always to speak to people. And so we looked in the Bible. Throughout the Bible, God was talking to people. And then we talked about the ways in which God would speak, and I have chosen some. Maybe there are more. I can't say that, I have a handle on every single thing. We looked at God's word. He speaks through Jesus Christ, his son, his creation, and that's where we stopped last time. God speaks us through other people, and that's where we will jump off today. But let me give you the rest. He speaks through music. Music is powerful, the way God speaks to us through music. And sometimes the music doesn't even have to have lyrics, just the music itself, because most times music is inspired by God himself. And the instrumentalist or whoever it is, the person who created the music, would convey certain messages without words, and the listener gets it. Some people talk about the effects of music on born babies. And I don't want to give wrong information, but I understand one of the biggest and best known writers of or modern day, well, it's not modern day, but music that we enjoy, his mother used to play the violin while she was having him, and he came out to be somebody who transcends the ages in terms of his music we play today. He's dead how many hundreds of years ago, and so on and so forth, right? God speaks through circumstances. There are some things that you don't have to have words. He can speak through your circumstances, and he can also speak through other person's circumstances. And sometimes it's good if we learn from other people's experiences. It doesn't have to be ours. He speaks through prayer. He speaks through dreams and visions. And there may be others added to the list. But I guess if I go through all of them, we probably wouldn't finish the series. So today we're going to look at, he speaks through us through other people. God places people in our lives for a specific reason. I remember looking at, listening to a message that Apostle Vivian had shared when he showed us the people that God put in our lives like a wall around us. So this baby was born and there's a circle of people all around. The circle is small at the beginning because it's parents, loved ones, grandparents, aunts and uncles, and that kind of a thing. As the child grows, the circle gets a little bigger because the child goes to school, and then you have teachers, and that circle becomes wider and wider. And he was talking about when we don't function, the people who form the circle around the child, when there's a dropout of persons from the circle, we leave a gaping hole in the life of that child. And children who are supposed to be protected are exposed to the elements, for want of a better expression. Actually, it's something that he will talk about called who is manning the gate. And he likes to talk about the daddy gate. It's a big gate, it's like a front gate. You know, usually you have little side gates in your house, like a back gate to go out in the back garden or something like that, a little side gate here and there. But the daddy gate is a big gate. And sometimes it's missing. So God puts people in our lives and he would instruct us through these people. So when my parents talk to me, God is speaking by far and large, because most parents would want good for their children. Very rare, and it happens, would you find parents who would instruct their children to do wrong. And I don't want to go off course, but that child is in a very difficult situation when your parent is directing you the wrong way, and especially if you don't know what, you know, right or wrong at that stage, and mommy or daddy says do this, or you see them doing it and you follow suit. That child is in a very difficult situation, as I say. Now, so we have parents, we have friends, we have teachers, we have preachers. Many people, sometimes mentors, we have coaches. If you think about yourself, you go to work and sometimes a senior person, as is the practice in many places, would take this youngster under his or her wing and begin to show you the ropes, mentor you, a nurse or a teacher, a young person, and you know, and they will say, do that, do that, do that, do the other. What you did, you know, that wasn't the best, try it this way, and so on and so on. And to my mind, these are all God sent to me. Those of you who may not know Apostle Vivian, I have three adult children, and each of them left Trinidad at 18 to study abroad on academic scholarships. And for every single one of them, God put somebody in their lives. He was their voice. He was the person who helped them along in their studies. I give God praise, because while Apostle Vivian and I were here teaching other people's children, parenting other people's children, God mercifully allowed somebody so many hundreds of miles away, unknown to us, who would take our children, they were, over 18, under their wings and help them. Donnell had such a person, and this person mentored him in Morehouse College to the point that she helped him in his transition from first degree to master's degree. You know, I remember I went to visit her to say thank you to her, and she was ill. And I prayed over that lady when I came back every day. It was critical. It meant life and death. And I was just there saying, God, and she was such a blessing to Donnell. Give her life back and so on. You know, and so I was happy. She was there talking to him, mentoring him. Dion, on the other hand, the strangest thing was the person who was there for him was somebody in the cafeteria, a cook. It wasn't somebody, an academic person. And she was there looking over Dion, somehow watching over him, was ensuring that he had something to eat. He didn't have a meal plan. His scholarship, that's the one thing that his scholarship didn't have. And she decided for some reason she would feed this boy. So he had access to the cafeteria. Somebody may have recognized, I don't know if somebody made a complaint that she was feeding Dion, and he couldn't come in the cafeteria. And she would, when one of his friends came, she would give them like double plates of food. And of course, if I eat and I don't want any more of the food, then I could take a doggy bag to carry out. And they would ask for a container. And she said, that is Dion's food. You understand? And save my son from eating ramen noodles. You know? So they were mentored. Then Patrice, on the other hand, in Howard, had somebody mentoring her as well. And this situation happened when she switched, after her first degree, went to the School of Dentistry, and the person who was in charge of the School of Dentistry took Patrice under her wings. To the point that Patrice still has a room in the lady's house. Every time there is some big celebration, somebody's birthday or anniversary, some big event, Patrice would fly down to DC to be part of that family. Her husband embraced Patrice. When they were going on some long tour, the young daughter was home. Patrice went and spent the time with her because they didn't want her to be by herself. God speaks through people. I'm saying to you that some of these people in your life, they are not incidentals. That person on the job who is taking you under the wings, and sometimes I may be talking to a young person who just started work, and you're shrugging off the person because they're trying to instruct you. Listen, that could be God's voice to you. Later on in your career, you look back and say, wow, that was the voice of reason. This person really helped me. And so God is going to put people in your life to speak to you. Listen to your parents. If you listen to me, let me tell you, youngsters, I know you know more than your parents. You know? I mean, come on. All of you know that you're a teenager. Teenagers know everything. And I remember Donald said to me, after he went away, and of course he's on his own, and life's experiences has to teach him. I always tell him that. I say, let me tell you, you don't want to learn the lessons that others want to teach you, life will teach you. And he called me one day and he said, Mommy, so you couldn't tell me I was wrong all the time? I say, well, no, I couldn't, because you wouldn't even believe that you were wrong. He said, oh my goodness, now he realized that he didn't know everything. I said, well, that's a good thing. That's just the process of life. There are people in your life that God would use as God speak to the yes, he does. And one of his greatest ways of speaking is through other people. Let me tell you about older folk. Just the other day, I was talking to somebody, and I was listening to somebody actually, and he was talking about this. He was a soldier, and in recent years, he met the person who started this whole, the army in Trinidad and Tobago. I think the gentleman is about 100 and something years now, and went abroad to work on behalf of the army, retired there and never came back to Trinidad. That's a whole lot of years. And this soldier, well, you know, that young, is trying to see if he could bring back this gentleman to Trinidad. And he sits there, and that man tells him not just the history of the army or the regiment, but the history of Trinidad and Tobago through his eyes and how things changed. Older people have a lot to teach us. And one of the things that we've lost is the extended family, where grandparents were an integral part of the family. Now, what is happening with us today, grandparents are getting younger, so they don't have no experience. I remember as a school teacher, I was amazed. I taught grandchildren, and I was shocked. I'm a teacher. Your career only span a few years. I taught the grandmother, I taught the mother, and I was teaching the grandchild. Now, obviously, the grandmother had to be pretty young in my career for me to, you know, and I'm saying, some of the children I taught, I said, but wait now, you have children, you're not supposed to have children that age. Your child is almost like the age of my children, you know, it's ridiculous, you know? But because grandparents, people are having children younger and younger and younger, grandparents are younger and they don't have the necessary experiences that we need to have. But I'm talking about people who lived, older people. And sometimes we think they're miserable, but it's good to sit at their feet and listen to their story. I know they tell us the same things over and over, but from that we can glean many things. They have had the good and bad of life. They've made mistakes, and at that stage in their lives, they're willing to tell you what they did right, what they did wrong, what worked for them, and so we can learn from them. You know, the practice now of having children visit homes for the elderly is really a very good practice. Let those children mingle with the older folk, have respect for the elders, because sometimes in these days we lose respect, well, for everybody. And I often say to parents, if a child is disrespectful to other people, they will ultimately be disrespectful to you, because we train them in a particular way. So older folk have a lot to offer. Would it be nice if, you know, you have in your family that we sit and communicate with them, have sessions with our older folk, include them in what we do. Sometimes we just put them aside and don't think that they have much to offer. And so, no, they have a lot if we give them an opportunity, and especially with our younger generation. We have friends, and God will use our friends to talk to us. Most of us have these best friends, but we have to be very careful when we take advice from friends, because usually most of us, our friends are around the same age as we are. And if you are young, so that means they're young and have no experience. Just that you don't know, they don't know either, you know? And so sometimes we cannot really take counsel from them as such. But it's always good to share. And if somebody really care about you, they will have the courage to say to you, this is right, this is wrong. A good friend will tell you when you're right, and a good friend will also tell you when you're wrong. A good friend will not want to fool you or lie to you. Now, I know I you have friends and you don't want to hurt their feelings. But if you are a true friend, you're going to have to be truthful. The Bible talks about talking the truth in love. So there's a way to speak truth, and it doesn't necessarily have to be condemning, you know, and so on. I could find a way. I know it's a little difficult for some people like me who you know, tend to be blunt and so on. But the alternative is not to fool the person. The alternative is not to lie to them. You have to be truthful. So we have to ask God, Holy Spirit, and He can do that. He's capable of doing that, to teach us how to speak truth in love, so that when you are a friend, you will be able to guide that person right. Teachers are in your life to help you along. There's a role that teachers play. Their job is to educate you. Their job is to prepare you for life in terms of career and that kind of a thing. Do not trivialize the time that you sit in that classroom. I tell my children all the time, well, they're not children anymore, and I probably don't have to tell them that now, but that the classroom is a great equalizer. It doesn't matter where you start. It doesn't matter where you came from. It doesn't matter which location in Trinidad you traveled from to go to that school. Education is a great equalizer. And if you maximize the education, then the time will come when there really is no line of demarcation between you and the person who came from a different part of Trinidad that is highly sought after. You can get a chance. Listen to your teachers. They are there to help you. God place these people in your life. I know there are some teachers, I was a teacher, and you know, we are not all that we should be. But the vast majority will be there to facilitate you, to help you along. Make use of the people that God would have placed in your life. God put pastors in your life, and for a very good reason. I remember trying to seek God about this whole apostolic move and all of that. And one of the things the Holy Ghost said to me, He said, Jemma, the apostolic primarily is a fathering anointing. Because in the Bible it says, we have many teachers, but we don't have many fathers. People with fathers' hearts. And the Lord caused a tear to come to my eyes, because He does that all the time, when He said to me, because so many people lack fathering, the apostolic is relevant today. Do you know that the pastor in the church will take the place of a missing father? That the pastor and the church could take the place of that missing element in your life, that you may not have been fathered, but when you come to church, the pastor's job is to now emulate God. God is ultimately Father. And the pastor stands in the place to represent God in such a way that you see God as Father. Because many times, if we look at our earthly fathers, we could misrepresent God. If I say, well, if He is Father and God is Father, well, I don't want no part of God. And I remember having a conversation with a young pastor's wife, and she said to me, I taught something, I went to a retreat and taught an Our Father. And she came to me after and she said, I cannot say that prayer. I said, how you mean? She said, if God is Father and my father was Father, I can't. She cannot say Our Father, because her father so tainted the vision of God in her eyes. She didn't want to hear the word Father. Of course, she had to forgive and so on. You know, it meant that there were some issues that she would have had with her father. So these are human beings talking to you. Whichever of these people, friends, parents, teachers, preachers, whatever, their words must line up with God's word. Whatever advice somebody give you, it mustn't contradict the Bible. Nobody must tell you to do something or advise you to do something that goes against the word of God. It must confirm or affirm truth. Confirm talks about you feeling inclined to go a certain way. I already plan to go, so I already decide to do something, and then I go to somebody and the person says, yes, it's a good idea, so and so and so, you got a confirmation. So it's very, very important. So I want to read a scripture, but before I do, let me tell you, if you have ever had caution from a good friend, God is speaking to you. Have you had admonition from a parent? God is speaking to you. As parents, have you ever had blunt honesty from your children? God is speaking to you. He said, a little child will lead them. Sometimes it's those little children, when they tell you the truth, it's hard to swallow. Have you had conviction from a preacher or an author? God is speaking to you. God used a donkey in Numbers 22, 28 to speak to Balaam. Balaam was very hard-headed. He wasn't listening to God, and he used an animal, a dumb animal, to speak. And he can speak through anything, anyone, anytime. And I want to close by reading from the book of James, James 3, 17. God speaks through the people in our lives. And I pray that you enjoy that privilege to have people in your life who will speak to you, you know. And so I'm going to read James 3, verse 17. It says, but the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and a good fruit, without partiality and without hypocrisy. If you want to know if what people are telling you to do is what you should do, then these are the tests. Pure, peaceable, gentle, easy to be entreated, full of mercy and the good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. I really hope I helped you this morning. Listen to the people that God put in your life. They are not just incidental. And there are some who have come into your life, and based on what I've said, you realize God didn't send them. And those are the ones that you can afford not to listen to. But there are people that he would send and will help to guide you along the way. Open up your ears, humble yourself, listen to the people that God has placed in your life. God bless you. Have you ever said to yourself, I really wish I can understand the Bible better? I want to communicate with God better. I want to be able to share my faith with others. Have you ever said, I'm reading the Bible, but I do not really understand it? Well, if you have ever said any of those things, I have really good news for you. My name is Jemma Duncan. My husband and I, Apostle Vivian Duncan, are the pastors of Divine Destiny Worship Center. And we have what we call School of the Bible. We started since 2014, and I'm going to give you a little rundown as to what School of the Bible is about and how we can facilitate you in fulfilling the needs that you have expressed. School of the Bible is a one-year course that runs from January to December. Every Tuesday from 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. And then we have 4 all-day quarterly sessions, 1 Saturday every 3 months. Inclusive in all of this, we have movies. Our main course material is the Bible. The Bible is the one and only resource book that you have to have. There are other resource materials that we will have on offer that you could choose to get or not get. If you choose, then you have to order those materials. But other than that, there are 7 manuals that we use. And these 7 manuals, you'll be going to see them on the screen, and I'll give you a little rundown as to what they are. The first manual, manual number 1, is the Pentateuch, the first 5 books of the Bible. Manual number 2 contains the historical books from Joshua to Esther. Manual number 3, the books of poetry from Job to Song of Solomon. Manual number 4 are the books of prophecy. And the books of prophecy, they are divided into 2 sections, major prophets from Isaiah to Daniel, and the minor prophets from Hosea to Malachi. Now, when you come to the school, we'll talk about why they are considered major and minor. Manual number 5, the New Testament books now, the books of history, the 4 Gospels from Matthew to John. Manual number 6 are what we call the Pauline epistles. The epistles written by Apostle Paul from Romans to Philemon. And then manual number 7 are the general epistles, and they have a variety of authors, and the book of Revelation, the one prophetic book in the New Testament. The manuals are simply written and user-friendly. They are easy to use, and you can use them as a tool for study in the future. This program is designed to meet your need to simply understand the Bible better. The Bible is the only test, as I said. Other resources are optional and available on request. Ask for a brochure at 633-3780, and you'll see the number scrolling across the screen. The brochure will contain all the information that you may need. We are now open for registration. I don't want you to ever forget that with God, everything is possible. See you next week.